So I want to introduce Mr. Yankas Abruzzi. And
bueno, Elba, Jorge, muchas gracias por la invitación y también muchas gracias para quizás contribuir mis experiencias y mi conocimiento a una audiencia que ya son convencidos de lo bien de Colombia, pues es como convencer a los ya convencidos. Okay, the order has been to do it in English, which I accepted, so I'll continue in English in a different tune, and I take off my coat like the gringos do, and try to not to mix up too much of the sequence which I thought I should say. Thank you. The subject that you gave is a very broad subject, and you can have a sermon of 40 minutes or 1 hour or 20 minutes or 10 minutes on this subject, and that subject I found this is very, well, it's more difficult than having a specific subject that the other speakers they'll touch. But this is one of the privileges of age, probably, that they give you difficult things to do. I wanted to start by freshening a little bit your memory. You all have a memory of the history of Colombia. I'm not talking about the past, but of the history of Colombia. And I would like to freshen your memory by discussing, first of all, as a background, three periods that I think are very important in Colombia, especially not only on the political development, which I will not touch too much, but on the commercial development. You have the pre-apertura, the post-apertura, and the 21st century. Now, the pre-apertura, the apertura was a thing that happened, a policy that happened in 1991, when the government of Cesar Gaviria came into power and started relatively rapidly in this thing by opening the borders of the country. And before that, the economy and the country as itself was much closed, was a very closed economy, which was concentrating on the inside of the country and not so much on the world. This means that very little was done on the infrastructure to the ports, that very little was done on the ports themselves, because export was not really a very important factor. And the problems in the interior, in a closed society, which also was of course dictated by the way nature has shaped Colombia with all the valleys and the mountain ranges and so on, was of course the focus of government, and everybody was inside in the country. Moreover, there were a lot of problems in the country. There was the guerrilla, which was an ideological guerrilla at the time, ideologically, that was supported very much mentally by Western European churches, normal people, political parties, contrary to, of course, what the government wanted. And there was, I would say, a very strong organization with the two carteles of cocaine. You know them from the movies or from the books or whatever, Pablo Escobar in Medellin, and the Cali cartel. These were well-organized operations, very criminal, of course, but well-organized. And the government had, of course, a lot of trouble to combat them. So the focus was on how to get this guerrilla out, which was not so very successful. Entrepreneurs in Colombia in those years were very feudal, very, how would I say, very hierarchical, very old-fashioned, so to say, typical of the Spanish heritage, you know, the hierarchies and so on and so on. And that meant that there was hardly any real progress in the economy or in manufacturing in the country. Contrary to that, the governments were relatively stable, relatively quiet, very high level, and very honest. And that is one of the things that I'd like to emphasize, that in those years there was a type of tremendous honor for a senator or for whatever official also to serve his country. Exports in those years were skimpy. There was a bit of coal, a bit of flowers, a bit of textiles, a little bit of minerals, but it was always a little bit. And the mainstay was coffee. Coffee at a certain moment did dictated about 60% of total foreign currency income of the country. So coffee was king, and everything that had to do with coffee was very important and very much appreciated by everybody. And I've witnessed those times, and I've seen that, for example, the manager of the Coffee Federation, which was a semi-statal thing, ordered the minister to his office and not the other way around. So the power of their power was a very big, big power. Then we got the Apertura in 1991, and then all of a sudden, very brusquely also, opened up all the borders. That means that that these borders had to also be served by infrastructure, by ports, but also a lot of opportunities for power. So many people grabbed power, especially political people, to have the power in the ports, because all of a sudden they saw there's an apertura, so the ports are important, so we have to be in the ports, and a lot of politicians and local governments took took an influence in managing ports, in the also in the day-to-day management, without having a clue of what it was about. The funny thing is that opening the borders was a big, big shock. For example, I was partner in a company for school supplies, and we had a monopoly, and it was big business, because we could dictate our margins, and so we made a lot of money in that company. Then after the apertura, the day of the apertura, we said, what can we do? We'll fight these things. But you couldn't fight the Chinese, so we went broke in about 2 years. And lost our money and everything. I mean, it's very logical if somebody offers at 30% prices of what you are, you know, you're illegally, so to say, selling it, as we did. But this opening was not only for many companies a big blow, especially because I said there were feudal companies and the hierarchies and old families and what have you. But there was also the fact, and that was the funny thing, that this coincided exactly with the fact that the guerrilla did not get their usual subsidies from the communist countries. Because the communist countries were paying a lot of money into the guerrilla because it was freedom and it was ideological. And they had money from kidnappings and so on, but also the main money came from subsidies. But all of a sudden communist countries went broke and stopped having money or stopped having relationships. And the fact is that the FARC people wanted to, or had to find somewhere, let's say, more ingressos, more money to spend, so to say. This was one of the very funny things, that they needed money, but after the cartels were cut off, Pablo Escobar was killed, and the Cali disappeared, you got a tremendous amount of small cartels, atomized cartels, so to say, small ones, who all were not so organized, were a bit wild, and so, but had power, and they had the weapons and what have you. But they needed somebody to take care of the plantings, because there was no coca in the years before 1990. There was hardly any planting of coca in Colombia. All the pasta came from Peru or Bolivia, and it was refined in laboratories on the 25th floor in Bogota. And once in a while, an apartment went, with a big bang. Stopped being in existence because they were in the lab and they were making cocaine for consumption markets. So they found each other very well. The small, let's say not the small, the disorganized, atomized cartelitos, so to say, with the people who knew how to guard and to intimidate and so on the growers of the prime material. And of course, in these years, it's nice to be only at guard, but it's nicer to be part of the supply line. So gradually in the years, in the last 30 years, the FARC took their place, a growing place in the supply line of cocaine.